In this segment, you're going to learn about the responsibility that's most often associated with trusted committership, and that is software quality. So we're going to talk about why it's important and also how trusted committers get their products to a certain level of quality.
As a trusted committer, you own all the decisions in the community, including those related to software quality. And that means that you are the one who has to make sure that these decisions are implemented. And that includes communicating them and also maybe defending them, both inside and outside of the community. It doesn't mean that you are the one who has to make all the decisions by yourself, or that you are the only one who spends all the time implementing them.
So what does a trusted committer do in practice to reach these goals? Well, it turns out that as a trusted committer, you have a lot of tools at your disposal, and we're going to discuss the most important ones. So it's the trusted committer's job to communicate and motivate quality standards in their community, and they have to formulate them in a way that's both understandable and actionable to the committers. So this, of course, includes some documentation and some written mentorship, but it's also in the way that the trusted committer embodies the idea of quality. I've seen in my work many times contributors are willing to follow a trusted committer's lead even without that being explicitly communicated because they see them as a paragon of the quality that they're trying for.
In my community, I have always made it a point that we should not just distinguish ourselves from traditional software development projects by the way we organize development, but also in terms of the quality of our products. And that has since become sort of an ethos of my community. And that's because we understand that high quality of the software is a precondition for regaining that trust in the organization that we need to run an InnerSource initiative successfully. And also we understand that this trust is easily shattered by just one bad release.
So in addition to setting a good example, trusted committers also most often impose quality based on peer review. And this happens through pull requests. So although anybody on the team can initiate or comment on a pull request, at the end of the day, it's only the trusted committer that can merge or accept a pull request or reject one.
And that is what I meant when I said trusted committers can push the code closer to production. And they will also want to help their contributors to get their contributions over the finish line. First of all, the review should be in a timely fashion. They might want to do short pairing sessions, or they might want to even refactor the existing code base so that the contribution fits in better. But ultimately, it's the job of the contributor to make that happen. It's not the job of the trusted committer to make sure that all contributions are accepted by default. And at all means, the trusted committer should avoid rewriting contributions so that they fit in. They should rather spend time with the contributor to make sure that this happens eventually. And they do this even if that takes much longer than they would have if they would have done it on their own. And that's because they understand that this support is a long-time investment in the community's longevity and also in the speed at which it will eventually move forward.
In most organizations, this alone is a sea change. The idea that quality comes first before shipping, before time pressure. And it's one of the things that you have to work the hardest to change. But it's an immediately rewarding thing as well. Quality almost always pops up when you start implementing a trusted committer practice. In fact, the time that is spent with a contributor mentoring in that first contribution accretes as documentation, which will be useful to subsequent contributors. And that's where all the velocity in InnerSource comes from. It's the first conversation is always expensive in terms of time, but then subsequent contributors can contribute much more quickly because they have the benefit of that history to instruct them without taking down anybody else's productivity. But let's come back to the project scope. It does happen sometimes that limitations of the software or of a plan are not discovered until during the development cycle. So they're not caught in the story cycle. When this happens, the trusted committer has to document them and make sure that documentation makes it back to both the contributor and the product owner. But we have to remember that trusted committers' purview is more than just pull requests. In fact, they take a very strategic view of quality overall, and that's because they understand that as the quality improves in software, it also makes the software more valuable to the organization.
And for the trusted committers, that means that they have to worry about code cleanliness and, for instance, also about the conceptual integrity of the software. But they also take on management-oriented tasks, like, for instance, making sure that the community is given sufficient time to do a refactoring of their software, or maybe even move a release date in favor of doing some quality improvements if the community deems that necessary. And that's because they understand that the effectiveness of them in their job depends heavily on the health of the code base. If that's not there, they will probably spend a lot of time validating and documenting workarounds for bugs or maybe a fragile architecture, and that is less time spent on onboarding and mentoring the contributors.
So now summing up, ensuring product quality is a key responsibility of trusted committers. They set and communicate quality standards and they lead by example. They participate in pull requests and they help contributors with their contributions to meet the quality standards, and they take responsibility for the long-term health of the software.